But to say that, every year we try to bring, in addition to all the other fabulous people who are participating in lecture series, a couple of career luminaries who really are folks who have been absolutely path-breaking in the transformative work that they've done with and for our community. And I'm very, very humbled and proud to say that today's speaker is one of those folks. Sarah Schulman is a novelist, nonfiction writer, playwright, screenwriter, journalist, AIDS historian, and actually just a really, really good person. Her honors include a Guggenheim in playwriting, a Fulbright in Judaic studies, and the Kessler Prize for significant contribution to LGBT studies. She's the co-founder of the ACT UP Oral History Project, which is a really important repository of an amazing period of direct action in our history. She's the co-producer of the excellent and award-winning film United in Anger, A History of ACT UP. She's on the advisory board of Jewish Voice for Peace and faculty advising the Students for Justice in Palestine at the City University of New York, and colleagues of Staten Island, where she's a distinguished professor. I am absolutely thrilled to have with us today.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Don and I met on Facebook, and look what can happen. Thank you so much for having me. Okay, so I'm going to start out with a little advisory note. I'm asking you to listen to these ideas the way you would watch a play, not to emerge saying, that play is right, but rather to observe that the play reveals human nuance, contradiction, limitation, joy, connection, and the tragedy of separation. That this is not something to be agreed with. This is not an exhibition of evidence, nor a display of proof. It is instead designed for engaged and dynamic, interactive, collective thinking, where some ideas will resonate, others will be rejected, and still others will provoke the readers to produce new knowledge themselves. Like authentic conscious relationships, truly progressive communities, responsible citizenship, and real friendship, like the peacemaking that all these require, it asks you to be interactive. So before I start, I want to say that this is my new book, Conflict is Not Abuse, and I wrote it before the election. However, the election has proved me correct, I believe. Because we now are dealing with a person, Donald Trump, who every single day tells us what a victim he is, especially when somebody tells the truth about him. Any kind of difference, opposition, exposure, or truth-telling, he describes as an attack, and he describes himself as victimized. And that's one of the concepts that I'm working with here, how people who are themselves perpetrators and are themselves bullies often describe themselves as victims. On the other hand, when you look at who voted for him, we also see that among his support, which was primarily white people, there's a group of white working class people in America who actually are oppressed in that they've been relegated to the working class, they've been in for multi-generations working in factories that have now disappeared because of the globalization of their jobs. But instead of blaming the white 1% who have taken away their employment, they have been manipulated into falsely accusing people who are not responsible for their fate, immigrants. And this is the other construction that I'm working with, how people who have actually been traumatized or actually been oppressed get manipulated into blaming the wrong party and expressing their anxieties in the wrong directions. So those are the illustrations from the world that we're living in right now that I hope will be helpful to you in thinking about these ideas. So I'm going to present for about 20 minutes, and then we'll open it up for questions, disagreements, debates, takedowns, whatever. Call me out, go for it. So I start with a quote from James Baldwin, who's a person that it's always helpful to look back to. And he said, "Not everything that is faced can be changed, but nothing can be changed until it is faced." James Baldwin. As I began this book during the summer of 2014, The human community witnessed systemic repetition of unjustified cruelty with exhaustion and frustration. We watched white police officers in Ferguson, Missouri and Staten Island, New York, murder two unarmed black men, Michael Brown and Eric Garner. We watched a rich and powerful professional football player, Ray Rice, beat his wife, Janae, unconscious in an elevator. We watched the Israeli government mass murder over 2,000 Palestinian civilians in Gaza. It quickly became apparent that the methods we've developed collectively to date to understand these kinds of actions in order to avoid them are not adequate. As a novelist, in order to create characters that have integrity, I apply the principle that people do things for reasons, even if they are not aware of those reasons, or even if they cannot accept that their reasons are motivated instead of neutral and objective. Using this principle to examine those events, I have to ask myself what the white police officers, the wealthy football player, and the militarized nation state think is happening that produces and justifies their brutal actions. As video and witness accounts attest, neither Michael Brown nor Eric Garner did anything that justified the way they were treated by the police. Eric Garner sold loose cigarettes and Michael Brown walked down the street. Both men tried to offer the police alternatives to cruelty. Eric Garner informed the police of the consequences of their actions on him when he told them 11 times while in an illegal chokehold, "I can't breathe." Michael Brown raised his hands in a sign of surrender and said, "Don't shoot." But something occurred within the minds, impulses, and group identities of the white police officers in that they construed the original non-event, compounded with these factual and peacemaking communications, as some kind of threat or attack. In other words, these policemen looked at nothing, the complete absence of threat, and there they saw threat gross enough to justify murder. Nothing happened, but these people with power saw abuse. We know from security camera footage taken in a casino lobby and elevator that Baltimore Ravens running back Ray Rice and his wife were having a quarrel. Now, as much as we do not like quarrels with our partners and wish they wouldn't happen, disagreement with one's lover is a normative part of human experience. It is impossible to live without it ever taking place. Intimate disagreement is, as they say, life. Yet Ray Rice experienced normal, regular conflict that exists in every relationship, family, and household in the world as so overwhelmingly unbearable and threatening that he hit his wife, knocking her unconscious, and dragged her limp body by the ankles out of the elevator, leaving her lying inert in a hallway. He looked at normative, everyday conflict and responded with extreme cruelty. He looked at the regular, even banal expression of difference, and he saw threat. The Israeli government has kept the Palestinian Gaza Strip under siege since 2005. This has made daily life unbearable for its inhabitants. In the late spring of 2014, the government of Benjamin Netanyahu escalated pressure on the already suffering Palestinians, and some factions within Gaza responded with rockets that were of such poor quality they had only symbolic impact. The Israeli government reacted in turn to this response with over 50 days of aerial bombing and ground invasion, causing mass death and massive destruction of literal, cultural, and psychological infrastructure. The Gazans were reacting to a state of injustice that the Israelis had created. The Gazans were resisting. They were refusing to go along with unbearable and unjustifiable treatment. The Israelis experienced this resistance to ongoing unfair treatment as attack. Brown and Garner did absolutely nothing but be black. Janae Rice expressed normal conflict. Gazans resisted unbearable treatment. In all of these cases, the police, the husband, and the nation overstated harm. They took nothing, normative conflict and resistance, and misrepresented these reasonable stances of difference as abuse. From the most intimate relationship between two people, to the power of the police, to the crushing reality of occupation, these actors displayed distorted thinking in which justifiable behavior was understood as aggression. In this way, they overreacted at a level that produced tragedy, pain, and division. It is this moment of overreaction that I wish to examine. My thesis is that at many levels of human interaction, there is the opportunity to conflate discomfort with threat, to mistake internal anxiety for exterior danger, and in turn to escalate rather than resolve. I will show how this dynamic, whether between two individuals, between groups of people, between governments and civilians, or between nations, is a fundamental opportunity for either tragedy or peace. Conscious awareness of these political and emotional mechanisms gives us all a chance to face ourselves, to achieve recognition and understanding in order to avoid escalation towards unnecessary pain. Of course, it is not only the police, wealthy football players, or colonial occupiers who can feel abused in the absence of actual threat. It is not only the dominant who feel endangered when faced with conflict or when their own unjust actions are responded to with resistance. In fact, these distorted reactions occur in both the powerful and the weak, the supremacist and the traumatized, in society and in intimacy. In arenas in which real abuse could conceivably take place, there are those who feel persecuted and threatened even though they are not in danger, and they often lack help from those around them to differentiate between the possible and the actual. Bullies often conceptualize themselves as being under attack when they are the ones originating the pain. Everywhere we look, there is confusion between conflict and abuse. If a person cannot solve a conflict with a friend, how can they possibly contribute to larger efforts for peace? If we refuse to speak to a friend because we project our anxieties onto an email they wrote, how are we going to welcome refugees, immigrants, and the homeless into our communities? The values required for social repair are the same values required for personal repair, and so this discussion must begin in the most micro experience. Confusing being mortal with being threatened can occur in any realm. The fact that something could go wrong does not mean that we are in danger. It means that we are alive. So, on a freezing snowy day in 2014, I was invited to a workshop run by a social worker named Catherine Hodes, a native New Yorker in her 50s. Hodes is an experienced professional with over 20 years of development and leadership in what was once called the Battered Women's Movement. And this movement is now called Intimate Relationship Abuse Advocacy. Now, intimate abuse is a real crisis for New York. The New York Times reported that the police received 284,000 intimate abuse calls a year, which is about 800 a day. And the New York police make about 46,000 intimate abuse arrests every year. But Hodes had boldly started to notice that her clients were increasingly confused about what the word abuse actually means, that it was overused. The paradox is, of course, that many women are unable to recognize that they are being abused, or they cannot get acknowledgement of this reality from others. But at the very same time, Hodes found that some women were applying the term abuse to situations that were really something else. Increasingly, she noticed that women who did not know how to resolve a problem sometimes described that feeling with the word abuse. So this session had been convened to address that trend directly with service providers. Hodes's focus was to help social workers differentiate between abuse and conflict so that they could be effective and directed and helping clients in ways that would speak to their real experiences. While identifying abuse is essential to saving lives and providing services, differentiating conflict from abuse is also essential to meeting clients' real need to learn how to face and deal with problems and to develop truthful assessments of themselves and others. Quote, differentiating between power struggle and power over, Hodes explained, is the difference between conflict and abuse. Abuse is power over, and conflict is power struggle. As we students discussed and grappled with this insight over the course of the day, my understanding consistently deepened. While obviously significant abuse does take place every day, where one person is being controlled by another or by a group in a manner that the recipient has not contributed to and cannot change, the word abuse has become overused. People may feel angry, frustrated, upset, but this does not mean they are being abused. They could instead be in conflict. Therefore, the fact that one person is suffering does not inherently mean that the other party is to blame. People may not know how to make things better, how to look at their own participation, how to deal with feeling badly about themselves. They may not know how to understand their own actions and are afraid of the implications of their actions on the meaning of their lives. And this may be devastating, tormenting, and painful. But this is not being abused. It does not get resolved by organizing the punishment of another person. People may be part of negative friendships, negative families, or negative communities who attack outsiders instead of being self-critical. They may be receiving encouragement to blame and scapegoat others. They may live within groups, relationships, or families that do not tolerate the admission of mistakes and that reinforce supremacy ideologies about each other in order to maintain illusions of righteousness. This pressure, resulting in the action of collectively deflecting blame, does not mean that the person being blamed is abusive. In fact, it says nothing at all about that person, except that they are being blamed. Now, it's interesting because some of the things that Hodes told us is that perpetrators increasingly are getting control of the abuse apparatus. So perpetrators increasingly are the ones to first call the police, to first threaten legal action, to send lawyer letters, or to threaten or seek restraining orders as part and parcel of their agenda of blame. And she noted the National Coalition of Anti-Violence Programs on LGBTQI intimate partner abuse showed that in 2013, the police misarrested the survivor as the perpetrator of violence in over half of all queer domestic abuse arrests. Misidentifying the perpetrator in same-sex relationships as the one who is butch, of color, not a mother, not a citizen, from another culture, or HIV positive. Now, one of Hodes' many valuable suggestions is to lower the bar for what must happen in a person's life for their suffering to be acknowledged. Quote, the current paradigm is encouraging all of us to think we are in abusive relationships, Hodes explained, and if you are not in an abusive relationship, you don't deserve help. Being abused is what makes you eligible, but everyone deserves help when they reach out for it. This is a strikingly humane idea that the collapse of conflict and abuse is partly the result of a punitive standard in which people are made desperate yet ineligible for compassion. This is a non-cynical reading of a human condition in which people who have suffered in the past or find themselves implicated in situations in which they are afraid to be accountable fear that within their group, acknowledging some responsibility will mean being denied their need to be heard and cared for. So they fall back on the accusation of abuse to guarantee that they will not be questioned in a way that confirms these fears. Especially vulnerable to this are those of us who experienced profound disapproval and criticism early on as children, who are later locked into self-righteous families or supremacy communities with negative bonds. Ultimately, the blurring of conflict and abuse, Hode says, is epidemic and leads to everyone identifying as a victim, which is paralyzing the search for solutions. I was moved and enlightened by her insight that conflicted people have to prove that they are eligible for compassion. No one can negotiate without being heard. Shunning, therefore, is designed to to maintain a unilateral position of unmovable superiority by asserting one's status as abused and the implied consequential right to punish without terms. And this is exactly what we see now with the anti-immigrant, anti-refugee, anti-Muslim arguments, right? That the people with the power are positioning themselves as abused or under attack when people who are actually in danger are the ones who are being depicted as dangerous. This concept of having to earn the right to have pain acknowledged is predicated on a need to enforce that one party is entirely righteous and without mistake, which is the centerpiece of white supremacy, right? While the other is the specter, the residual holder of all evil. If conflicted people were expected and encouraged to produce complex understandings of their relationships, then people could be expected to negotiate instead of having to justify their pain through inflated charges of victimization. And it is in the best interest of all of us to try to consciously move to that place. So at this point in writing this book, I started to ask myself, you know, how did we get here? What is the history of this? And I'm going to just share a little bit with you casually some of the information in subsequent chapters. So for example, I was born in New York City in 1958. And in 1958, the laws regarding women were so bad that, for example, if you wanted to get a credit card, your father had to sign for it. Things like that. They had separate job listings for women and men. And women were paid significantly, you know, were overtly paid less than men. But laws about safety were also very detrimental to women. So in the year that I was born, if a woman was raped, you could not get a conviction based only on the victim's testimony. You had to have a witness corroborate what had happened to you. So the environment was really absurd. In the 1960s is when you start to see the beginning of the feminist movement against violence. And it emerges in the context of many global movements in the 1960s that were very, very radical. Anti-colonial movements, all kinds of black liberation, women's liberation, gay liberation, lots of movements around the world of people who are trying to radically transform how we live and how we relate to each other. So when this feminist movement against violence began in the 60s, they also had like a very big visionary view. And when you go back and read their materials, you can see that they felt that male violence against women and children was caused by three things: patriarchy, poverty, and racism. So they saw it as a manifestation of structural problems. And they started grassroots movements and grassroots services to try to counteract this. So they invented things like hotlines, rape hotlines, or battered women's shelters, or self-defense classes for women. And the demand was huge. Now, in the 1970s, there was a program in the United States called CETA, where the government would pay the salaries of people who ran grassroots community organizations. But when Ronald Reagan was elected in 1980, and that is D-Day for a lot of the problems that we're having today, one of the first things he did in his first 3 weeks in office was he eliminated CETA. So all of these programs lost their staff people, and they couldn't keep up with the demand for services. Through the 1980s, you start to see the government taking control of all of this. So things against violence against women, things against family violence came out of control of the community and became under the control of the government. So in order to work in these government bureaucracies, you had to have certain kinds of credentials, you had to be a certain kind of person, and the who was supposed to be enforcing these rules? The police. Well, this creates a crisis of meaning, because not only is the US government one of the greatest sources of violence in the world, but we certainly know that the police are incredibly violent. And in fact, of all the professions in America, police officer is the profession with the highest rate of domestic violence of any profession, including NFL player. So clearly, these were not the right people to be asked to solve problems. And we see it all the time on TV. You know, somebody has a fight with their son, they call the police come, they kill the son. You know, we're constantly seeing that we're turning to the police and asking them to solve problems that they're not capable of solving. Now, it's interesting, in the same period that this transition was taking place, there was a lot of propaganda on television for this idea. And this is where things like Law and Order Special Victims Unit first appeared during this period. And if you look at those shows, especially in the early years, They're always arguing that there's one perpetrator who's perfectly evil, there's one victim who's perfectly innocent, and the answer is the police. So instead of communities or friends or families being called on to encourage each other to understand what is actually happening in the conflict and to help each other reach out and negotiate, we're being told or encouraged to feel that the police are the appropriate arbiter of our intimate relationships. And there's a shift, because instead of trying to understand what happened, we're trying to figure out who to punish and how to punish them. And when the government is in charge of punishment, it's always people of color and poor people who are going to get punished. You know, it gives the government much more entree into people's families, into their homes, higher rates of incarceration. It couldn't be farther away from what the feminist movement of the 60s focused on, because the US government is not looking to stop patriarchy, poverty, and racism. They live on patriarchy, poverty, and racism, especially the current administration. So this is kind of how we got to this moment. And then I give two examples that I think are really good case studies, and I'm going to summarize here and wrap up so that we can talk, but of how this shift is seen. Now, one example is the Israeli war in Gaza in 2014. And if you analyze Israeli government language about themselves, they're constantly using the language of abuse to describe themselves. They're always saying how they're under attack. They're always saying how they're being threatened. They are the perpetrator. You know, they are a massive military power that has occupied and made and subsumed another people, the Palestinians. And yet they're constantly describing themselves as though they're the victims. So they're great users of this manipulation of abuse language. And Donald Trump is the perfect example. I mean, every day, multiple times a day, he's telling you how abused he is. But another example has to do with HIV, and I've been writing about HIV since the AIDS crisis began in the early 80s when I was a young journalist. And you know, one of the questions about HIV that's really fits into this paradigm is that now that there are medications so that people who are HIV positive can live a full lifespan if they have health insurance. So the problem is the lack of health insurance, not the HIV. But instead of saying that our problem is that we deprive people of health services, we're constantly stigmatizing people with HIV, not seeing them as people who need support and who are endangered and need help and care, but as people who are somehow potentially there to abuse everybody else. So there you see the paradigm over and over again. So in short, just to summarize, I think that what we see over and over when we look at the big picture is that at an intimate level, when we abdicate responsibility for the conflicts that we're actually participating in creating, we are being part of a paradigm that ultimately enhances the power of the state. Okay, thank you very much. Well, I think that the answer is with the group. And we've been seeing demonstrations of resistance all across our country, right? So the group of American people who do not want to, you know, do not want a white supremacist state, more so than we had before, which was already in place in some regards. where we see massive amounts, thousands, millions of Americans who are protesting. And what they're doing is they're enacting the responsible group, who's standing up and saying, no, this is not the way to go, this is not how we want to live, and is trying to, in our way, encourage the powers that be to wake up and find another way. And that group is also important in the intimate. Because, like, I'm amazed how often people ask me to hurt someone. Like, people say, like, why are you talking to her? Why did you go to her party? Why did you invite her? You know, people are always telling you to isolate somebody and to shun them and all this kind of thing. We have this idea that if you're a good friend, you hurt the person that your friends want you to hurt. But I think that that's a negative relationship. And I think that real loyalty and real friendship and real love and a real healthy family is the person who says, how are you contributing to this conflict? And if you tell the truth, I will still love you. I will not punish you or exploit you or humiliate you. And how can I help you and this person communicate? Not, yeah, I'm going to hurt this person because you told me to, but rather, how can I help? How can I help you solve this? Because we have to solve our problems with each other on all levels. Because look at where we're at. We're in a national calamity because of blame and scapegoating. Instead of communicating and solving problems with some respect. And it's on a personal level and on a social level.
Did you see we had two questions? You want to follow up?
Okay. Somebody back there. Well, I mean, clearly people disagree with me every day. Oh, he was asking me, what do I do when people disagree with me? I mean, when you write a book like this, people are going to disagree with you, right? Because I'm like I said at the beginning, I'm not saying that I'm completely right about everything either. I just want us to talk about it. I just want these questions to be out in the world. But, you know, I think one of the biggest arenas in which I deal with disagreement has to do with Israel and Palestine. Because I'm Jewish, and because I support Palestinian liberation, I'm constantly in dialogue with other Jews who don't understand the issues, and many more and more Jews do understand, and more Jews are opposing the Israeli state, but there's some who have problems with it. And it's, you know, it's really important in those kinds of conversations to not escalate. You know, so sometimes you're dealing with somebody and all they want to do is call you names and stuff like that, and you can try to clarify a few times, and if they're not listening, forget it. It's not worth it. They're not going to change their mind. But public debate with someone like that is beneficial, not to change their mind, but to show the audience what the different positions are and how people handle themselves. You know, so I mean, that's like a daily experience for me. Oh, there's someone behind you, Don.
So I find it more difficult to discuss these types of issues with people who want to stay neutral rather than are completely opposed to what you're saying. How would you approach something like that?
Well, neutral is not neutral. You know, so what's called third-party intervention. In other words, there's a responsibility to intervene when someone is being oppressed. You know, and because sometimes somebody is being put in a position where they don't have the power to make the situation right, and then you have a moral and ethical obligation to intervene, even if you're not the person at risk. That's sort of the definition of being a decent person. So when people say, you know, I just don't want to get involved, oh yeah, Trump is blaming all of America's problems on Muslims, but I just don't want to get involved, what they're actually saying is that they're going to stand by and let that happen. You know, they're not telling the truth about what they're really doing. Because this is a moment where nobody can stand by. Everybody has to respond. And millions of people are responding, and we have to keep doing it. It's very beautiful to be in New York and see thousands of people in California demonstrating at an airport when you're at an airport in New York. I mean, that's the way to go, people. You know, it's very exciting. Yes.
So again, you mentioned that in the 80s, Reagan reversed the movements from the 60s and 70s and the civil rights. Do you see this going back to being more of a state issue?
What do you mean? Oh, I see what you're saying. Let me just say that nobody knows what's going to happen, because the people in charge don't make any sense. You know, the president is mentally ill. I think that that's clear, right? And they're not logical. So we can't responsibly say that we know specifically what's going to happen. But there's a lot of options. I mean, one thing that we're seeing is this kind of blue state secessionism, you know, that blue states and cities are saying, we are going to be sanctuary cities. We're not going to cooperate with this witch hunting of immigrants, and that's a really beautiful thing. Now, how are they going to respond to that? Like, are they going to send in troops to California and New York? I have no idea. They're crazy, and I don't know what they're going to do. But I do think that more people who live in red states and don't like what's happening are going to be moving to blue states. You know, I'm expecting huge cultural shifts in American culture and bigger counterculture. And counterculture is a beautiful place. Counterculture is when different kinds of people get together and say, we do not agree with this dominant cultural idea. We want to live differently, and we're going to do it. So when you go to these demonstrations, and there's all kinds of people there who are not usually mixing, and they're all in the street together, they're going to get to know each other. They're going to be talking to each other. They're going to be building things together. They might be sitting in jail together. Who knows? But we're going to enrich each other and produce alternative ways of living. And that's one of the great things that happens out of resistance. It's one of the most important things.
So can I just ask a follow-up on that? So do you imagine that a possibility then would be that that there would be more of the problem-solving, conflict resolution coming from within communities in this kind of cultural
that's
model,
whatever,
right?
Yeah.
Ironically,
oh,
Reagan, you know, Republicans are supposed to give power to communities and away from the federal government. But ironically, right, what he did was to take power away from communities by taking the funding away and then putting the state apparatus in charge of punishing abuse, right? Do you think that one of the effects of this countercultural moment might be, right, that we might move toward more community-based conflict resolution?
I mean, formally and informally. But, you know, it's like just getting together and planning a demonstration or planning the resistance, or I don't know, is this a sanctuary campus here at Sonoma?
The CSU has a unstated opinion that they will do everything that sanctuary, the UC do, they'll do everything that sanctuary campuses do without calling themselves a sanctuary campus for fear of what might come on the other side of that.
You may decide, students, and I'm saying this as an outside agitator, that that's not good enough. And you may decide that you want to organize a student movement here to demand that this campus be called a sanctuary campus. And if you do that, a lot of your theory will emerge. You know, as you make concrete decisions about how to organize and what kind of events you want to do, I'm assuming they're going to be nonviolent. You're going to have to do nonviolent civil disobedience training, all this kind of thing. Your real values, which is your theory, right? Your values will emerge. And in talking to each other, you'll develop that together. So I think, you know, the solution to these anxieties, I think, are in the group relationships. You know, like in a bad family, somebody is a scapegoat and that person gets blamed for everything. Or outsiders are always wrong and family members are always right. That's, to me, a negative family. A positive family is one where people are self-critical, they're allowed to question themselves, they're encouraged to treat other people fairly. You know, it's like dialogue, negotiation, self-criticism. That's what the healthy group is, and that's how you get a healthy society, or a healthier one. Yes.
I finally watched a clip of him. But I'm getting this idea that people are feeling that you cannot be allowed to speak on college campuses and have free speech because he uses hate speech. And I'm wondering, and like your get on this, is like, are people over-exaggerating the harm of what he can do and thereby like really narrowing the definition of free speech?
Hey, Ed. Hi, I know this guy.
I just want to say I'm so glad the record brought you here so that Don. We don't all have to try to find our way to San Francisco.
Thanks.
Thank you so much.
So I'm going to answer your question in a way that you may not expect. So I think one of the big question they're asking is, what are the right tactics for us right now? And I'm a historian of the AIDS activist movement. I run something called the ACT UP Oral History Project, which you can go to online. It's at actuporalhistory.org. And I made a film about this movement. It's called United in Anger, and you can watch it on iTunes. And that is the last, most recent successful social movement in America, is AIDS activism. And when you analyze why they were successful, I think one of their key winning points was that everyone, they had simultaneous reactions. Different kinds of people responded in different ways based on what they thought was right. They didn't try to control everyone. So in other words, in that movement, if you wanted to do something and I didn't want to do it, I just wouldn't do it. I wouldn't try to stop you from doing it. Or I wouldn't try to force you to do my idea. I would get people who liked my idea together and we would do that. So you had all different kinds of people on all different kinds of levels responding in the way that they felt was best. And that was one of the reasons that AIDS activism was successful, because there was simultaneity of response. Okay, so in other words, I come from that, and so I don't believe in trying to control or force people to respond in a way that doesn't make sense to them, because I think that people can only be where they're at. I wish it wasn't that way. I wish everyone could be exactly where I'm at, but they're not, and I'm not where they are. So while I personally would not go to a demonstration to stop someone from speaking, I would not oppose other people who feel that that's what they need to do right now to show opposition to Trump. The reason I personally would not do that is because I find that historically, once you start censoring people who have terrible things to say, and that becomes acceptable, then it gets turned on you. Whereas if you have a principle that everyone can say whatever they want, no matter how horrible, you also get to say what you want. So like, that's my take on it. But if that's where people are at, bless them. Go for it. Because we have to show that what's happening is not acceptable. Yes. Sure.
I've seen a few media outlets that are saying they say contradictory things, and it's kind of one of those things where you kind of don't really know.
Okay, so what's your name?
Thomas.
So what Thomas is talking about is a global phenomenon called HIV criminalization that has been coming up around the world. It's strongest in Canada, Taiwan, and in the United States, it's on a state-by-state basis. We don't have a national standard. In which if a person who is HIV positive does not disclose to their partner, they can be charged with a crime. Even if no one gets infected, even if they're on medications that make them not infectious, even if no one could get infected, even if they used a condom. So what you can see in the ideology of HIV criminalization is that even though it sounds like it's about protecting people who are negative, it's actually used to stigmatize people who are positive, who may not even be infectious. Now, there's 34 million people in the world who have HIV. Being HIV positive is a normal human experience. So many people are HIV positive. And people get infected for all kinds of ways. And every single person here knows that sex is really complicated, right? And doing what you're supposed to do around sex sometimes feels impossible. And sometimes communication feels impossible, and sometimes there's shame around sex, and sometimes there's confusion. And sometimes people get HIV infected because of those very human issues. So let's go back to Catherine Hodes, who's like saying, everyone is eligible for compassion. Let's try to understand why people get infected instead of trying to figure out how to punish them. In this case, it was a black man who had infected two white people in the state of Missouri, the same place where Michael Brown was killed by white police officers, and he got a 30-year sentence. And I assure you that race has a lot to do with that case. If every person who infected somebody in the world was put in prison, there'd be millions and millions of people in prison. It's not a solution. The solution is an adequate healthcare system where every person in America gets the healthcare that every human being needs and deserves. And if everyone who was HIV positive could get the healthcare that they needed, they would be virally suppressed, which means they would not be infectious and they couldn't infect anybody. That is the answer, not blaming people who are sick. So that's my answer. So you see the logic, right? Every conflict, I'm saying, let's stop punishing people. I mean, I'm 58 years old, and let me tell you, I've never seen punishment work. Let's try to understand what's happening and see how we can help each other negotiate through problems. It's just an alternative way of looking at life rather than trying to figure out who's wrong and needs to be heard.
Okay, let's take one more question.
Of course, because people are responding. And the answer is students. I mean, the Vietnam War ended partially because of students, just saying, like, this is not the world we want to live in. And as a student, you have power because you're part of an institution. And if you bond together, you can force that institution to do things that it needs to do. This is a very powerful community that you're part of. And you're the future. And I think we should end on that.
Okay.
Thank you.